exciting day here on York School campus. The sunny school on our hill. Not today, but bringing us some sunshine are some alums of recent. And we've set up a number of questions to kind of go through. We have students representing different classes from York, different years. We have students representing big schools, small schools, East Coast schools, Southern California schools, all over, and different paths as well, right? So right now, all of you are locked in this achievement mode, and you're picturing your future, and you're working hard on your classes, and you're thinking, okay, after your school, I go to college, and bada bing, bada boom, this happens. But we're all on individual paths, and I think as we go through our conversations today, you're going to recognize some of these students and hear their own personal path, which is really nice. So what we tried to do here at York while we're called preparatory is really just to prepare you for the path that you go on. It's not necessarily a straight line. I should be starting that. I'm going to start with the first question. We're going to go down the line here, learning a little bit more about the individual experiences that these Yorkies have. Thank you. And how about a warm welcome?
One thing I miss about York, obviously the professors, also I miss my sports teams a lot. And also knowing everyone's name, I feel like I neglected that when I was at a small school. So now I live in a big school, it's kind of harder to get to know everyone.
I'm Arnold. Arnold, class of 2021. I also miss the teachers a lot. I think being in like, such a close relationship with the teachers like, really fosters growth as a student, as a person. I also miss being on our own. It's a really beautiful town.
I'm Camilla. I'm your class of 2022. And one thing I miss about York is walking around campus and being able to say hi and see so many people that you know all the time.
My name is Jerry. Graduated class of 2019. One thing I miss is the sunny hilltop, but apparently it doesn't miss me. I do miss the bonding I had at the high school and the close connection I had with the faculty. I see a lot of new faces.
Hi, I'm Tom Siletto. Class of 2019. One thing I miss about York, actually two things. One is going to Cuba with his piece in my sophomore year, and the second one would be playing lacrosse for Mr. Martin.
Next, please tell us what college you attend, your major area of study, and why you chose that school over other schools, and if you want to include size, location, whether it's public or private, that's fine.
College in California. I'm a computer biology major. size is kind of small, and like when I was touring larger schools, I felt really overwhelmed because I went to small schools all my life. But mainly I went there for the creative writing program specifically. I already knew what I wanted to major in. I feel really lucky in that way because that's like probably the hardest part of the process to find the best fit for you. And I've gotten really lucky and I love the creative writing program there. And they also have a 100% study abroad rate, so it's a graduation requirement. I really wanted to study abroad, so that was another reason I went.
I go to Columbia University in New York City. I'm a history major. I have a minor in film. I actually went to Santa Clara University for my first 2 years of college, and then I decided to transfer, which is a process. If you have questions about it, you can talk to me. I definitely wanted to be someplace that really stressed academic rigor, but also being able to immediately apply that to your surroundings. New York City seemed like the best place to do that for me.
I go to Oakland College. I'm undergrad major, but I'm in the process of declaring neuroscience. I chose Oakland because it's a small school, and I actually went to where the admissions guy comes in and talks to you about the school. It's one of those events that Mr. Bartlett hosted, and the admissions person told us that OBs don't like rules, and that's actually what made me really consider Oakland and looking for them. And I noticed that Oakland has there's very little structure, but like in a good way, there's a lot of opportunities for students to grow at the rate that they want to grow at and kind of do the things that they want to do and learn. And I really like that, so I applied there and I went
in. I go to Bryn Mawr College, and I'm an intended biology major with a possible chemistry minor, but I really don't know as of yet. You only have to declare in your sophomore year. And I chose Bryn Mawr because it's a historically women's college, and I really like that environment. And I really appreciated the community that I found as soon as I went on campus, even just a tour. And it's also a very good school for sciences, which I appreciated.
I go to Occidental College in Los Angeles. It's a small liberal arts school, size of around 2,000 students. I chose this school because I had the opportunity to play E3 basketball, which is something I really wanted to do. But then most importantly is because the location is in Los Angeles. And I was always looking forward to living in a bigger city, facing all of the choices that you have. You might need to want to go to a beach town for school. So after class, you can go surf all day. Or maybe you want to be in the city, get a cup of coffee. But for me, LA is good for me. So that's pretty cool.
I go to Berklee College of Music in Austin. I'm actually a transfer student, so I did my first 2 years at the University of Puget Sound. Washington, and I decided that I wanted to study music. So it's a school of about 5,000 kids. I study music business and music production. It's cool. Boston's a great place to go to college. I've come to a lot of schools there, so if you guys are all interested, I have friends at all of them. We can talk about it. It's a cool place.
If you could give York students one piece of advice to help them find the right fit college, or better prepare them for the college application process, what would that piece of advice be?
Yeah, well, I'll try my best. I remember when I was in your shoes, I was pretty nervous, and I felt a lot of anxiety, just because it seems like you're at this turning point that you're like, that it go really good or really bad, but that's not true. Like, that's just like a false assumption that I made. Any college you choose will be right for you. You're going to do this a lot, but you have so much time to choose what you want to do. And you hear it a lot because it's true. So just keep that in mind. Relax.
Yeah, I would think there's something along the same lines. Just like taking the anxiety out of the process. I know the process is a little bit easier for me because I already knew what I wanted to study, so I've already narrowed it down. But yeah, it definitely is just like kind of overwhelming because there's a big choice in your life. I think also just like taking the pressure off to go to college and like actually figure out what you want to do, because I know a lot of people, or not a lot of people, but some people feel like their mental health is really bad in college and they're still like trying to get through it, and I think it's really important to take time off if you need it. I ended up taking a gap year because of COVID. I never intended to take a gap year. don't have super high SAT scores, but I didn't want something that was super academically rigorous, and that was like what was right for me. So I think not caring about like the perceived is really important as well.
Yeah, this one will seem a little bit obscure, but check the core curriculum at whatever colleges that you're applying to, because you're going to be stuck in those classes for 2 years primarily. So if you don't like the core curriculum, it's not going to be as enjoyable. So I'd say that first. Also, kind of going off Jupiter's comment, being a transfer too, I thought that I kind of had to stick to one college and stay there forever. And it is a very daunting process to transfer, but also if you don't feel like where you are is a good fit for you, like it's not going to help you thrive, then it is also an opportunity to change where you are. Even like that can be as small as like changing your major or changing what you're studying. That can also be changing universities. So I'd say don't feel like whatever you pick has to be what you do for the entirety of your college experience. You have flexibility. And the whole point of college is to be able to know what you want to do in the future, and that does require some kind of like navigating, being flexible. So don't feel that stress of like, this is what I want to do, I'm going to stick to that. Of course, if you have that plan, it works out for you, that's great. But also, don't feel hard pressed to stick to one thing that you decide before you're even there.
I think it's important to consider like what kind of environment you want to be in, whether you want to be in like a city or in the countryside, and how many people you want to be around you, and whether you want to be in a place where there's like a lot of music. Something that I consider when I was going to Oberlin, I wanted to go to Oberlin because it is primarily an conservatory. I'm not primarily, but partly a conservatory, and I knew that I'd be surrounded by music when I went there, and that's something that was important to me. And just like thinking about the kinds of people who you're going to be around when you go to college, I think will really help decide where you end up.
Yeah, so my advice for the application process would be to find a sort of genre of colleges, of college you're looking for. So maybe go on a bunch of tours and figure out that maybe like the small private liberal arts college or maybe a big public school, whatever it is. Apply to a bunch of those, and I know that there's a lot of pressure to kind of have a dream school in mind, but I don't think that that's, well, if you have one, that's great, but if you don't, that's totally fine, and just weighing the pros and cons of a bunch of different colleges is a lot easier than having your heart decide completely on one.
Yeah, so I think it's important to go see it for yourself first before you go. You never know the type of environment that you will be in is what you're familiar with or what you really like. So I was fortunate to have a sleepover at hostel before I even attended when I was a student. So, and I really liked the environment and all the people that I was around with. Yeah. About the application process, I did early decision, so be very careful with that.
Say that don't be scared if you don't get into the school that you really want to go to, because you will find out that you will end up at a place where you can be happy. I would also say that acceptance rate, etc., doesn't really matter to school. I studied my first 2 years at a school called the University of Puget Sound. It's like an 88 acceptance rate school, so it's not considered like super prestigious, but I will say that the professors I have there are 10 times better than the professors I have at my current college. Berkeley's great because the people, there's great musicians, great music everywhere, but I would say the acceptance rate isn't indicative of what the professors and the faculty has to offer you. I would say go to a place that you really connect with instead of going to a place that you think other people are like, wow, they're not there. I'd say go to a place that you really feel is like could be home for you and that you can connect with on an academic and social level.
Going to put a fine point on that very wise comment there. We get locked into thinking that, you know, if it's not in the top 50 colleges on U.S. News and World Report, you're not going to get a quality education. That's just not the case. There's so many colleges out there. I think more importantly is maybe access. access to the professors and hands-on education at the institution that you're going to versus whether it's, you know, number one or number 52 in some kind of really arbitrary rank, because really good professors, that's what's going to make your college experience. Here's a fun question, dorm life. How was it adopting to dorm life? A little different than living at home?
Well, I would say yes, it's very difficult to secondly, I met my roommates online, which, you know, it's not usual. I mean, I guess it is pretty usual for like first years to meet your roommates online. It ends up working really well for me. I'm still friends with them, I love them. But I would say you don't have to be best friends with your roommate. It only matters if like you have boundaries and like you can talk to them about conflicts. Like you're gonna be fine. Yeah. Sorry.
No,
like,
sure.
I don't have much time to think about answers.
Oh yeah, we can reverse the order next time.
Yeah, I kind of had a terrible dorm experience my first year. Unfortunately, I had, for my first semester, I had a really bad roommate. We just like, I thought we worked really well on paper. We were randomly placed, and it was based on like a questionnaire they had us fill out. And so I thought we worked really well, and it turns out we just had really different temperaments, just like we're not getting along at all, and I was like trying to stay out of my room as much as possible. And that wasn't really working for me, so I ended up changing roommates, which I think is a really important thing to know about, at least at my school, it was fairly easy, but I also know it can be kind of a difficult process depending on just like the logistics stuff and like who's in charge of it at your school. But I think don't be afraid to like change your roommates if things aren't working. But also like you can try to make it work, and like Nora said, you don't have to be best friends with them, although I am currently best friends with my roommate. I have a really great roommate this year. And so far that is working out for us, but I think it can be tricky to room with your friends, and definitely like be careful about that, because like you can have a lot of conflict and tension about the room that will like get into your own relationship. And ways of communicating to each other, your boundaries, that can be really tricky. But yeah, the dorms aren't that bad. Like, communal bathrooms, not the best, but like, it could be a lot worse. And especially a lot of schools, like, have really good first year dorms now. So definitely take advantage of really nice dorms when you have them, because I didn't realize how good I had it. I know I have a pretty crappy dorm these days, so take advantage of that.
Yeah, so my first 2 years at Santa Clara, I did not have a good dorm experience. I lived in a suite with 8 girls, and that was just not for me. So I'd say, not about Columbia actually, though I have a really good accommodation, but I think you just need to be really honest with yourself about like how you live, because every college will ask you like basically the same questionnaire, like, are you a night owl or a morning person? Do you like living with people? Like, don't kid yourself and be like, oh, I think I would like this. Like, if you think that like there's something that after a year worth of like living with someone, you're gonna get a defense up, I'd say just be completely honest about that, because if you're the type of person that really likes living alone, then make sure you make that clear, because there are ways to accommodate that. For me, I now live in a single, I don't have a roommate, I much prefer that just because I have control over the entirety of the space where I'm living, which is something that I prefer. But yeah, if you can, sometimes dorms can be a bit complicated, the process in college, but if you can, be as honest as you can on those questionnaires, because where they place you will be primarily based off of that.
My Oberlin first year dorm was kind of soft, but I would say that communicating with your roommate, like everyone else said, is really important. My roommate came home every day at like 4 in the morning, and he had his stupid little night lights on, and I couldn't find a switch. So I didn't talk to him about that, I just suffered through it, but I just probably should have talked to him. I would have gotten a lot more sleep that year. Also, wear shower shoes, bring shower shoes.
Going off of the shower shoes thing, I had a couple of friends this semester who realized that the shower shoes are not just for walking to the shower, they're for being in the shower. So remember that when you're in college. Aside from that, I'm currently embroiled in a bit of plot drama. So my advice in that regard with roommates is to set up boundaries early in your relationship, because then you get a few weeks in and you're thinking, oh, it's too late, I can't say anything, and then it just kind of devolves from there, and your plot ends up becoming a triple. So So I would just recommend that you set clear boundaries that you agree upon and you genuinely think you can live with.
So I only have one semester of roommate experience, and I kind of just let this my destiny takes me. I just signed up for a random roommate. We had a great run, but yeah, I had to move out the next semester. So ever since, I had a single for the past 3 or 4 years. It's great. So. I can't really speak on that. But be careful who you choose to be roommate with. For the summer, I had an off-campus housing and with one of my best friends from college. And that was the greatest summer ever. So it's very important to find a person you actually connect with and bond with and share interests on basically every level. So don't be scared to just choose strangers. It's always fun.
I would say we both be here is setting the boundaries. My freshman year, my roommate would be like, hey, can you come back at 3 a.m? Because he wanted to spend time with his girlfriend, so I would be stuck in the library until 3 a.m. It's terrible. I didn't like it. I would say that setting up those boundaries and being with someone as a roommate who is very good at telling you when they are upset about something is very important. I decided to live by myself in an apartment for the next couple of years. But this next semester, I'm living with my best friend, Nina, in Valencia. And that's going to be really fun because I know that Nina is a very good communicator. So whenever we have an issue, we say it right away. And as roommates, that's the most important thing, because the worst thing that can happen to you with a roommate is when it gets passive aggressive or you're not communicating about things. Most issues with roommates arise because there's a lack of communication. That's if you communicate, if you're a good communicator, and you make a point to, and your roommate also does, you're not going to have an issue. It'll be okay. But just make sure that that first week, you set down those boundaries and you draw those lines, because it's really important.
Yeah. Excellent. And we'll start with you. We'll work early this way, giving you more some time to prepare. But this one has, might not actually apply to everybody. Were any of you waitlisted? If so, did you write a follow-up letter or do anything in particular to up your chances of admittance? So waitlist for the rest of the school is you've applied, you get accepted, yay, you can get rejected, woo-hoo. Or you get waitlisted, which is this limbo of, you know, maybe we'll let you, we'll see what everybody else says, and then we'll decide whether we let you in or not. So you kind of are in this waiting pool, just kind of waiting around.
I just got denied straight up.
To them. I know that when I was in grad school, they like, my file, and they, like, I mentioned.
And do you have any advice or strategies that worked for you to make sure, to make you realize that it wasn't personal? If you have any experience with getting denied, please share.
I mean, honestly, like, I was so conceited. I was just like, well, they're lost, so, you know? But at the same time, you know, I think that rejection is this big taboo thing, especially in high school. You're like, oh no, I'm not going to get to a good school, I'm not going to be successful. And you just got to remember that, right? There's a million successful people that, first of all, didn't go to college. Second of all, went to a college that you probably never heard of. So you don't really need to worry about the most prestigious university ever, because, you know, you are you and you make the most of your education. And if you make the most of your education, you expand your brain in your own way, you know, you're going to learn things that they couldn't have taught you at those prestigious universities. So I wouldn't be worried about getting rejected. It happens to everybody. You know, just keep your head up and be like, well, you know, there's always a second chance. I can apply for transfer. It's not the end of the world. It's fun. Honestly, almost everyone in this room is going to get rejected. It doesn't matter. You're going to be fine. I promise you.
Yeah, there isn't really a metric for how successful you are at the moment. You know, you shouldn't be scared because the institution doesn't validate you based on what you look on paper. You know, you will always find the place that suits you and that you will flourish in. Just don't be afraid to just keep going and keep getting rejected until you get.
Yeah, I know it's very much a cliche, but it really is mostly just about fit. Looking back at the colleges I was rejected from, I can see now that it just wouldn't have worked out well. And some of them, yeah, I wanted to go, but I ended up being fine at a different college. And in the end, it's really, you're gonna, like what people would say, you're gonna be happy, you're gonna make your own community wherever you end up. It doesn't really matter about the one college or any college in particular. If that makes sense.
Yeah. When I got rejected, I kind of just thought, I didn't want to go there anyways. One school that where rejection like kind of hurt me a little bit was I applied to Amherst in Massachusetts, Maine. I actually really wanted to go there for several reasons, but when I got the rejection letter, they were like, oh, you know, like 3% of our applicants got in this year, and I was like, oh, okay, they're all probably nervous that we're going to get along with them. That's kind of the way I go.
Give a little story too. I got rejected from Columbia when I first applied, and now I go there. So, like, your first round of applications is not the end all be all. If you really feel that passionately about going to a certain school, like, there are more opportunities to get there. And even if that doesn't work out, like, really, your college life is going to be what you make of it, and you have a lot of control over that. So, do as much as you can, and you can control, and whatever else.
Yeah, so I kind of sidestepped the rejection process in a way because I applied to like only schools that I kind of knew I could get into. I kind of was like at a very target range, and I only applied to I think 6 schools, and I only got rejected from one just because like the other ones were really much in my target range, and I got rejected from Emory, which I wasn't expecting to get into. I thought maybe I had a chance because my nana went there, so it was like kind of legacy, but not really. So I was like definitely a very reach school for me, and I didn't even know that much about the school, and it was kind of just like a shot in the dark type of thing, but I didn't even visit the school, like I didn't know that much about it. So yeah, I think a big thing for me was just that I didn't want to stress myself out with applying to like 20 plus schools like some of my other classmates, just to make sure that I could get in somewhere, but I didn't get a lot of rejections back. So I think it's okay to only apply to a few if you like that's what you really want, like you really to, I really like, tell you, like, oh, you should apply to lots, like, make sure you get to one. Like, even if you don't get into any of them, like, at least you're going somewhere that, like, you care about, you know? And also during, I just want to say during my gap year, I am going to MPC for a few classes, the local community college, and kind of talking about what some other people have been saying about how it's not the most prestigious school, it's the best. I had a really good experience at MPC. It was online school, unfortunately, but I had really great professors, and, like, the stuff that I learned about was really interesting and really helped me when I eventually did go to a four-year school. So, like, don't be afraid to just, like, take a year off and do a project and, like, go to MBC, go to Hartnell or whatever. There's some really great professors there. You can learn a lot of cool stuff.
Yeah, I mean, what I was going to say is that it's kind of a game. Like, the college admissions process is pretty absurd. There's a lot of variables that have nothing to do with you. It's just about what Sophia was saying, how many people didn't accept that year, or how many people didn't accept the financial aid. Like, it has, I mean, obviously it has a lot to do with the application, but, like, a lot of it is just like stuff that you don't, it's not a reflection on your ability or,
This next question, let's do it like popcorn. So whoever wants to answer it. And this is an important question. Do you have any advice on how to manage parent or family expectations? So sometimes you might have parents that are like, yes, go to this school. Lots of pressure. Or you only must go to schools with this in their name. You have to do this. A lot of parent and family pressure that you might hear and experience explicitly, like they're like, this is the only college for you. Or you pick it up indirectly. It's like, they're always talking about this one school. Might be kind of important to my family. Was there any kind of pressure? How did you deal with, how do you manage parent or family expectations? Anybody?
I would say, if you know what you want to do, go do it, especially at music school. I have some friends that dropped out against their parents' will, and funny enough, they just did a tiny desk with us in Cal High that got toward Crazy Abro. So like, if you know what you want to do and you're ready to do it, go do it. I would say going to college is a very great stepping stone for that, so definitely go to college. But if you know right away when you're in college and your parents are like telling you to do something that you have opportunities, like see you get a job or see you, get, especially at Berkeley, this happens all the time. Kids get offers to go on tour. Like, one of my best friends is on tour with Will Cotton right now as a guitarist and just dropped out of school. And if you have those opportunities, I would say the reason you go to college is to get those opportunities, but you, if you have them while you're in college, don't give them up. Do your thing. You know, especially if you're in art school, I don't think that applies as much to, you know, if you're studying engineering or something, but if you're ready to do something, do it. Don't be scared that, oh my God, I have to do this step to get there. Do the steps that feels right to you, and if you have those opportunities, take
them. I want to speak directly to the international students, because I was an international student. I want to have, you know, parents overseas always have high expectations of where you are going to end up in. But, you know, just know that at the end of the day, you are the person who's going to school, and you don't know everything about what college experience is like. Just be true to yourself. Do
have to be confident in like your own experience and what you know you want to do. That's kind of been said before, but also too, I definitely felt family pressure, especially when I was transferring. The transfer process is really risky sometimes, depending on where you're applying. And I was in a very good situation at my previous college, and my mom kind of said, well, if you're going to transfer, it better be somewhere good. So in that sense, like, be very, very, like, honest with yourself about what you want and be able to, like, separate that from what you think you're expected to do. I think I definitely felt a lot of that pressure initially going in. The college I ended up at first ended up not being the right fit for me, but then being able to transfer really felt like I was choosing for myself. And like moving from the West Coast to the East Coast is a big transition too, but I think being able to establish like communities away from home is so valuable to be able to like expand your network, not only like academically, but also in your career. And that is something to think about. Don't feel like you have to be rooted to where you grew up. Of course, don't burn those bridges, but I do think there is a lot of value being able to make an independent choice, and I think that college is one of the first major life independent choices that you get to make.
Anybody else? Let's take a moment to open it up to the rest of the school. Any questions from the students? We have alum from going to colleges across the nation, from music conservancies to private liberal arts to Ivy League. So any questions? Could be about student life, could be about the academics, the college application process. How do you handle waiting for decisions, seniors, when after you've already submitted applications and you're biting your nails waiting for a decision to come in? Any kind of question. I see one right here. You have to be really loud.
Alright. How's it like when you have to go to school across the country? How's that like?
I'm going to a school in Philadelphia, and I can say that it's definitely a mixed bag. It's really cool being able to explore a part of the country that, or the part of the world that you've never really explored before. And I think one of the things as Californians we need to prepare for is weather. Well, we're getting some now, but cold. It's really cold. Other than that, it's really nice. It's hard being away from family and friends you have, but it's a really great opportunity to kind of start new and experience a whole, it's really different on the East Coast. It's a whole different way of life, kind of. So yeah, I think it's great.
Yeah, like I said, I go to school in Maryland, so literally right across the country. And I would say get ready for a lot of airplane, like get used to airplanes and airports and all that kind of stuff. Like I spend so much time in them now, it's not really that fun for me, but you just kind of crazy so you can get through it. But yeah, it is definitely kind of like a whole world over there, and it's, for me at least, it was very strange to think that I'm so far away from home. Like my brain can't even conceptualize that I'm on another coast when I'm over there. But it is really cool to be able to be independent and actually feel like you're doing stuff on your own, and even though like your parents aren't like right close to you, it is kind of nice to just be like, oh, I need you to help myself, and like if there's a problem, I kind of have to figure it out, like I can call them and ask for advice. But there's not a lot they can do physically here, so like you really are on your own, but I think it's important to think about if you are ready for that, because everyone's in different stages by the time they go to college. But for me, it was definitely a great choice, and I wanted to get away from California and see like another part of the country I've never been to before. And it's really fun that you get to like go on road trips there, and you, in 3 hours, you can be in 3 different states, and it's really cool, and you can see a lot of different stuff while in California, you know. You're always kind of in California for a while. Yeah, I definitely recommend it. You see new things and meeting lots of different kinds of people.
Hi, I'm crashing the party. Quick intro, Jordan, class of 21, time's a blur. I attend University of Missouri, Columbia in Columbia, Missouri, also known as the Zoo. So I live in the Midwest, which is, well, maybe not as far away as Philadelphia or Maryland, maybe a very different culture. I say my biggest advice would be to listen to the people that live there. When they tell you, hey, wear multiple layers of pants, wear multiple layers of pants,
happens. Because it's wind chills of negative 30 outside, we're going to get hypothermia, and you're not. And also just, you know, various other cultural things. You know, anything. Listen to the people that live there. And also as a quick aside, when you're looking at the places, cost of living is a good thing to look into as well. No one mentioned that. You can rent a place for $300 a month in Columbia, Missouri. That makes things easier in a lot of ways.
So when you say $300 a month, you can rent a place. Is this like a small shoebox, like closet?
It would be great, but it would be a room, right?
Live in a house.
A room in a house.
Right.
And I'm in a nicer apartment now that's more on campus, and it's still less than I would pay for student housing with the dormitories. I get, you know, last year I was in a 10 by 19 room with two beds, and now I'm paying less, and I have a room with a private bathroom in an apartment that's bigger than my house here with a kitchen and a thing. It's like, you know, 700 a month or something like that, right? It makes things easier in many ways, in a way that I don't think is really talked about always, right? So don't be afraid to look into places you would never be able to think of living, especially if you're in a more difficult financial situation. There are really good scholarships, especially for people on the West Coast, in places like Missouri, Mississippi, like Savannah here.
Savannah, stand up. Talk to any of these students before you head out.
Hi, I'm Savannah. I go to the University of Mississippi. I'm studying Chinese. Living in the South is also a whole new world. A lot of stuff being left. I don't know. Checking out a Southern school, I wasn't expecting a lot of stuff when I arrived. It's definitely like Jordan said, listen to the locals when they tell you about stuff because it is way different. And cost of living is nice in Mississippi too. It's a lot of different stuff.
One last thing, don't be afraid of the people there. They're all really nice. You hear a lot of stories, but it's just phenomenal people. These are people who deserve, and I'm sure it's this too.
So one more question from the audience in the back here. Really loud, really loud. You hear that okay?
I work with very different doctor and I work 8 hours. I wouldn't recommend it to anybody. I think if you work on campus, it's very hard to balance that out with academics. So if you're gonna do work, do like research, do something that's not, you know, a dead-end job at a dining hall, because that job like really takes a lot out of you, and also physically, like, you're making like $80 a week, so it's not really, you're not really getting that much out of it relative to like other things that you could be doing. So that's my choice.
Nora.
I think
I was basically just like a cameraman for like all the different sports teams, and I got like that allowed me to take a break from studying. So I think make sure if you are going to get a job that it is something that's either applicable to what you're studying or something that you do enjoy that's like a hobby outside.
Yeah, I think for your first semester, if you're going to work, I would recommend an on-campus job.
Did you want to go ahead? Upon dismissal, if anybody wants to come up and ask individual questions, you can. Outside of that, let's just give everybody, let's give them a round of applause.
Yeah.